The moment that hope was born, and guilt was pardoned once and for all, and captivated.
As I was approaching, there were so many rumors out there. I wanted to tell the story and share all the details. I'm driving east on 8094, and I'm getting off onto I-65 South. I live in Holbrook. So I'm taking that ramp, and I thought that's where the crash occurred, but it did not. I must have fell asleep already. Here's what I do remember. I remember that my license plate did not have the current sticker on it. And so I was going to, like, renew the plate. I knew it didn't have the current sticker on it. So I was going to get off on Broadway because I was starting to feel tired. And I thought if I got off on Broadway, the stop and go traffic would wake me up, but that didn't happen. I was going to get off, and I seen a state trooper. And I said, yeah, I think I'll go down to I-65. So I go down to I-65. I'm telling it all today. So I'm going to go down to I-65 instead, and I'm going to take I-65 south, and I'm going to take over to the Ridge Road exit east. I thought I was on that first turn. I was not. I was actually past the I-65 ramp, and I even moved up to the where I-65 goes into the Ridge Road exit, right there. And I just entered into that turn, and I must have went. That's what must have happened. I must have dozed off because who knows? I might have been already when I got off on I-65. I don't remember. And so all I remember is it was a violent collision. Picture 55, 60 miles an hour. I don't know what I was doing. And then zero. You know, when you hit your brakes in your car, you screech to a halt. There's a stopping process where you go from 50 to 40 to 30 to 20 and it slows down. But when you're driving it, 15, 20. When you leave here today, drive down the street at 20 miles an hour, picture running into a telephone pole or something that's not going to move, and imagine what your body's going to go through at that 15 or 20 miles an hour, from 15 to 20 to zero. No stopping, stop. There's a collision that takes place, and this is what happens. The first is the impact from the vehicle. Second is the impact with your body in the seatbelt. Praise God, I had my seatbelt on. 98% of the time I wear it. 2% of the time I forget. Jump out, pump some gas, jump back in, I forget. But 98% of the time I wear my seatbelt. And so thank God I had it on. So your body hits the seatbelt. There's a violent collision there. There's a vehicle collision, impact between whatever object you hit. There's a collision between your body and the seatbelt, and then your organs that are floating inside your chest cavity are going to impact something. Your brain is floating inside your skull, is going to impact your skull. And that's where concussions come from. It's violent. 50 miles an hour, which I think I was going at least that, to zero. So I must have dozed off and then, bah! I hit something and I hit the right. You got the picture, Brandon?
Yep.
Now, the left of my car. This car is an old, raggedy old car, but man, that's my baby. She never let me down. This is the driver's side front. There's the passenger side. The passenger side hit a street sweeper that was parked on the side of the road. What in the world was the street sweeper doing on the side of the road on the ramp? I don't know. Maybe he was sweeping, but I don't think so. He was parked. I don't remember seeing it. All I remember is my windshield spider webs out. It goes pow, and I mean I'm asleep. I'm out. I must have dozed in, and boom, the car hits, and I wake up, and my body, because it's the front passenger side, goes to the front passenger side. That's where my body goes, and everything in my car goes to the front. Whoa. To the front, things under my seat, everything. And as it goes forward, somewhere in there I wake up. The collision wakes me up, and I remember thinking, what the heck is going on? And I look, you know, it's a rude awakening. And I'm trying to see through the spiderweb windshield what happened. Amazingly, my mind was functioning coherently. I don't know how in the world that happened, but I smashed into this thing, and I'm trying to look through my windshield to see what I hit. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, did I hit somebody? Did somebody dead? What happened? Where am I? And all these thoughts are going through my head. I open up the driver's side door, and I turn in my seat to get out of my car, and I put my feet onto the pavement. And as soon as my feet hit the pavement, I tell myself, don't get hit by a passing car. You know, you survive a car crash, and you get out, and then you get ran over by a semi. I mean, that would really stink. Hey, he lived. Oh, he's gone. You know, that would have been terrible. So I get out of the car, and that's what I tell myself. Don't get hit by a passing car. And I look over my shoulder, and cars are going by, and I walk to the front of my car, and I remember thinking, you did a number on that one. And I remember saying to myself, I'm going to need a ride home. Yeah, I'm going to need a ride home. And then I sweepers, and what's happening on this passenger side, diesel, because I must have smashed into the gas tank of the street sweeper, is pouring in through that passenger side on the front floorboard. I didn't know it. Everybody who knows me knows I have a horrible sense of smell, so I couldn't smell it anyway. But also, I got out right away. I got right out the car. By a miracle of God, I stood up and I walked to the front of my car, thinking this can't be that bad. I got out. And then I looked at the car. I said, wow, that's pretty bad. And so then I told myself, you know you can't breathe, right? I couldn't breathe. So I'm hunched over like this, and I'm trying to catch my breath. And I'm taking deep breaths, and taking deep breaths, and I'm telling myself, calm down, Jose. Catch your breath, take deep breath. And I'm breathing. And my first thought was, I punctured my lungs. I thought the rib cage cracked, punctured my lungs. This is what I'm thinking. Nobody's telling me nothing. I'm thinking my rib cage cracked, punctured my lungs, they're gonna collapse, and I'm gonna die here on the side of the road. That's exactly what I thought. And I have to be totally honest with you when I tell you this. I was okay with that. I was. But they said, Mr. Burgos, what we're gonna do is we're gonna put you in a room and we're gonna monitor those blood clots. So I'm sitting here in the emergency room overnight. So Friday morning, she comes in, she checks my eyes, and she says, you're good. And I said, that's what I'm talking about. God is good.
Amen.
Okay, so she leaves. Then they find me a room. Praise the Lord. It's like almost noon. We're going to put you in a room. So they send me up to this room. They never hooked me up with the morphine drip they promised. One that you can hit every 8 minutes. But since 7 in the morning, they asked me, do you want some morphine? And I said, no, I don't. I said, but I'll take some Motrin. So I was taking Motrin. And so they said, you don't want no morphine? I said, no. So hours lapsed from 7 in the morning till probably 3 or 4 in the afternoon. I had no morphine. People, my family's huge. If you know my family, I got a big family. And they're not the quietest bunch of people. So we're in this room, and I know we got to be annoying my roommate, who was really cool, by the way. And so I'm going stir crazy in a bed for one day. And I'm losing my mind. I got to get out of here. Hurt and I got stretched and I stand up and I'm not hooked up to nothing, so I walk up and down the hallway getting some exercise. My daughter Christy brought me a pair of basketball shorts so that I can put underneath my hospital gown. Thank you. So I'm walking up and down the hallway getting some exercise, and then I walk out to the waiting room where this is right after you left, and the waiting room where the rest of my visitors were waiting, and I'm sitting out there with them telling a story, and we're laughing and we're joking. The nurse comes up to me and she goes, I've never, ever seen a man with broken ribs get up out of the bed, walk down the hallway, and visit his visitors. And I said, praise God, giving God the glory. In my vehicle, my airbags never deployed. People are like, oh my God, I'm glad they didn't. Because your airbag saved your life. No, God did.
Amen. Say it.
What's no airbag? The airbag didn't deploy. I'm grateful that they didn't. So it would have robbed God of his glory. She tells me, hey, your ribs, I can't believe that. And I said, yeah. And I said, what about my blood clots? Because she's leaving. I'll see you tomorrow. She was really cool. Dunkin' Donuts coffee, by the way. If you need to go to the hospital, go to the Dunkin' Donuts coffee. I'm like, yes, life is good. There was a picture of me on Facebook drinking it. It was good. Man, it really was good. Oh, and I knew it was going to be all right after that. I took a swig of that. I'm like, oh, thank you, Jesus. But I go out and I'm visiting, and so the nurse tells me, I've never seen that. And she's leaving. She says, I'll see you in the morning. It's 7:30 at night. She works 7 in the morning to 7 at night. It's 7:30. I said, what are you still doing here? She says, I'm leaving. I said, hey, what about those blood clots? That's why I'm here. That's why St. Mary sent me here. This is what Loyola confirmed when I came into the emergency room. And she looks at me and said, what blood clots? I said, that's what I'm talking about. I look over at Sonny. You know Sonny. Sonny's crazy. Sonny goes, God's just showing off now. She says, well, I don't remember anything about the book. I said, hey, see you in the morning. So she leaves. My other nurse comes out. She's like, you want to get back in the room? So I have to check this. I'm like, I'm coming. So I go down there, she checks me out, and now I'm going to bed, I'm tired. I said, you know, I'll take some morphine now, and I want to make sure I get a good night's sleep. But before that, before she left, there's a video around here. It's supposed to be top secret. Where I laid back on the chair, and I said, oh, I checked into this joint an hour, a day ago. I'm all banged. banged up, three broken ribs, cracked sternum, and I go through the whole thing, and I stand up as I'm telling the story, and I literally started dancing in the waiting room. In the video, you know, Tina said, don't let people see that. They're going to think you're faking. I'm telling you, I was giving God glory.
Amen.
And God praise. Because there's no doubt in my mind that it was the prayers of the people that healed me.
Yeah.
In such a speedy manner. I mean, it was ridiculous. So then, I go back to my room. I tell the nurse, I said, listen, this is the midnight nurse. I said, do me a favor and send a trauma doctor in here so I can talk to him. I want to talk about these blood clots. All right, no problem. Well, he didn't come. He didn't come till the next morning, and it wasn't him. You know who it was? It was an ophthalmologist. I said, I already saw you yesterday. Oh, no, you saw my associate. I said, well, what are you doing? Why we need to take the test again? I said, why? Well, we just need to take it. He didn't believe it. He didn't believe her report. He didn't believe her report. He said, I got to check it. So he checked it again. The doctor came in with another one of his cronies, and they did the exact same exam that they did the day before. And he goes, And I said, what? He says, it's fine. I said, that's what she said. He goes, it's going to heal without surgery. I said, that's what she said. He goes, I said, imagine that. He couldn't believe it. The night before, when I was in the waiting room, when I was dancing, the chaplain walks up. I almost forgot this one.
Yeah.
This is a great story. Uh-huh. This guy walks up. Chaplain. Don't miss that. Hey, how you doing, brother? Comes over and he's visiting with me and the guests. And I'm telling you, I'm looking pretty good. I just danced the jig for Christmas. Well, so I'm looking pretty good. This is what he tells me. He says, so what's going on? I tell him, short story, broken ribs, broken sternum, blood clots, that's why I'm here. I said, but the nurse just left, and she said, she don't think I have any blood clots. This is what he said, man of God, and I'm giving praise and glory to God Almighty for healing. This chaplain looks at me and goes, well, what hospital was you diagnosed with blood clots with? I said, St. Mary's. And his response, and I'm paraphrasing because I don't remember exactly what he says, was they misdiagnosed you. You didn't have any blood clots. They don't know what they're doing. Clearly, we do. I said, well, in that case, I said, you guys messed up too because you confirmed what St. Mary said. And he goes, huh. And Tina, I look at my wife and she's like, you know, she didn't do that, but she was looking like, you can go. Clearly, God has been a miracle has taken place. And I'm looking at him like, hey, dude, you can go now. Yeah, we squared away here. That's what he said. I said, you're so squared away, you affirm what St. Mary said. I have blood clots, and now I don't. So the next morning, the ophthalmologist leaves. I'm like, excellent. So he leaves. I'm like, send me the trauma doctors, because if I have no blood clots, I'm going home. I can rest at home. These three guys come in, and I don't mean to poke fun at doctors, so please forgive me if I sound like I'm arrogant or rude. But these three guys come in and look like Moeller and Curly. They come in, and they say, hey, you know, how do you feel? I said, I feel great. About 900 grand, almost $1 million. They said, really? I said, yeah. I was up down the hallway, walking and visiting. I said, I breathe, I don't hurt. I can't believe it. They go, well, the ophthalmologist. No, he said, have you seen an eye doctor? No, have you seen Dr. Yu? And I said, is that the eye doctor? And they got offended. Jesus, ophthalmologist. I said, yeah, I saw him. He said, I'm good. He said, oh, well, we really got no reason to keep you there. I said, what about the blood clots? The doctor in the middle goes, looks to the one on the left, looks to his right, looks to the one on the left. The two on the ends look into the one. They look like the Three Stooges. I'm waiting for them. They're looking at each other for answers. These were the same guys that met me in the emergency room the night before. And they look at me. They look at each other. And they look back at me. And they said, what blood clots? And I said, praise God. I get my car. I call my wife. Hey, we're out of here. We left. And we're home. And I was home, and people at my job said, hey, we was coming to visit you, but I can't believe you're out for a day and a half. I said, me neither. I have a seatbelt burn. The next day was almost completely healed. My supervisor from work, who's been a policeman for 25 years, comes in and looks at me, and he goes, that, he points, because I'm wearing no shirt. He's looking at my seatbelt burn, he goes, that looks a week old. A week old. People say, wow, you were lucky. Wow, you got out of that car, and you must be Superman. You're great health. I'm in pretty decent shape, must have contributed. I said, I'm telling you, don't rob God of the joy of the fact that he answered a prayer. God performed a miracle in my life, and I will not take any credit for that. None. The people were praying, and God was moving. Prayers go up, and blessings come down. Amen.
Amen.